In the summer of 1997, the Hot Stove Luncheon was pleased to present special guest Alan Trammell. Alan had just retired from 20 years in a Detroit Tiger uniform, which placed him in the august company of Al Kaline and Ty Cobb as the only Tigers to play 20 or more years in a Detroit uniform. Alan Trammell clearly is one of the best shortstops in the history of the major leagues. He was named the most valuable player of the 1984 World Series after hitting a .450 with a pair of homers as the Tigers defeated the Padres in 5 games. He finished his playing career ranked in the top 10 in the 10 primary statistical categories when his career numbers are compared to those of shortstops currently in the Baseball Hall of Fame, including home runs at 185 and fielding average of 977. Both categories, he is higher than any shortstop in the Hall of Fame. He's one of the career leaders in the Detroit Tiger record book. It is also worthy of note that he set an American League record with shortstop Lou Whitaker for appearances by teammates with 1,918 games together. I'm sure you will enjoy Alan Trammell's speech in 1997 before the Jamestown Hot Stove Luncheon.
The father and then the grandson all coming out and the granddaughter coming out to see the game.
During the celebration, everybody all had a common thing. They had forgotten about all the negative parts, negative things in life. We all pulled together. We are all happy together.
It's a dream for me to be able to start and finish my career with the Tigers.
Hope one day I'm back in that Tiger uniform because, you know, as they said, Willie, that's where you belong. That's where I know I belong, and it'll be part of Willie Horton life until I pass away.
Didn't know that I was born in Orange County, and I moved to San Diego when I was very small, and grew up and you know, spent all my time as a kid in San Diego, and I have to admit that it was not a bad place to grow up. As we go back now, the city has gotten bigger and bigger, but when I was a kid growing up, it was a smaller city, and it was outstanding. I happened to grow up close to the ballpark there, and I used to spend a lot of time sneaking into the ballpark down there. It wasn't very hard, for the fact that back in 69 when the Padres started, they weren't very good, and they didn't really have a system as far as of trying to keep little kids out that wanted to get in real easy. Basically, they had a couple gates open, and they didn't close them until 3 or 3:30, so if you came down in the early afternoon, you just walked right in. You just stayed in there. And a couple of my buddies used to keep an old little stub in our pocket. It was like a raffle ticket. It had no date on there, so if it was a general admission ticket, it was the same. So every once in a while, you'd pick one up on the ground that looked new. So if eventually, if an usher caught you or something, you said, hey, you know, I got a ticket to be in here. And we used to just hang around and go underneath the stadium and do little things that kids would do. So I enjoyed that time. Before that, though, I mean, like Little League and stuff, I was always, as you can imagine, I was a good athlete as a kid, and I had good hand-eye coordination right from the get-go, and you know, working with my dad all the way up. I was always a good player, maybe not the best player in the league, but always one of the better players because I was very small and very skinny. And so I didn't hit for much power, but I always hit the ball, but I was always a pretty good fielder. And as I got up through the ranks, you know, I continued to just enjoy all the sports. I played all the sports, but as I got into the high school level, that's when I pretty much played basketball and baseball. And most people thought that I was going to go play basketball somewhere. I had a couple of small scholarships, school scholarships to play basketball. But as you can imagine, in baseball, you don't get a lot of people to come out to watch you play. So everybody assumed playing basketball, we were pretty good. A few people come out to watch you, that's what I was going to do. But I think I made a wise choice. Baseball has been very, very good to me. And I did pretty well in high school, too. But again, you know, not too many people take notice of that. When I was a senior, I hit close to 500. And we did pretty well as a team. And I had signed a letter of intent to go to UCLA. I had committed to go there. I had went out to Arizona State and UCLA were the two schools that I was pretty much considering. And I elected to go to UCLA. For whatever reason, I just decided that was the place that I felt I was going to be more comfortable. Well, lo and behold, a couple weeks later, they have the June draft, which is what we had just a couple of months ago. And I was selected by the Detroit Tigers in the second round. And they offered me the chance to play professional baseball, which really what I wanted to do anyways. But my parents were thinking that college was the way to go, and we kind of went back and forth a little bit, and I elected to sign a professional contract, and the rest, I guess, is history. I got into the system very quickly. They sent me to Bristol, Virginia, and I was telling Mike the other day that one of the first things that I remember about going to Bristol, Virginia, because growing up in San Diego, we didn't go anywhere. I went to L.A. My grandparents lived in L.A. That was as far as I ever went as a kid. So if you're familiar with the West Coast and the way it looks out there, it's brown, it's yellowish, you don't have a lot of green trees like you have out here. And when I got off the plane and went to the place where they put us up for a few days in Bristol, Virginia, I was shocked to see how pretty it really was. And that's the first thought that I remember about coming back, you know, the Midwest or the East, about how pretty it was. They threw me into the ringer. They give you 3 days to find a place to live, put you up at a hotel, and I was like, I was a little disoriented, to say the least, because normally, you know, you have mom to cook you your meals, you have your own room, and I think they might have told me some of these things, but when you sign in a professional contract, I don't think you're really thinking real clearly. You're just thinking you're going to go play professional baseball, and that's a dream, you want to do it. But you don't think about any of the things about where you're going to sleep and where you're going to eat and all those good stuff. And it was a real eye-opening experience to have 3 days, and they say, okay, well, did you find your place to stay yet? Not really yet. So I hooked up with a college guy, and we shared a place. He did the cooking and I did the cleaning, and it worked out well because he at least had been away from home for a little bit. But no pots and pans, no nothing that I had brought with me. I didn't have my own pillow. I had a few clothes and that was it. And they're working you pretty hard. You're going to early work and you're pretty much spending most of your time at the ballpark. So it was an awakening for me. I adjusted to it, but I was only there for about 6 weeks, and for some reason they happened to think that they, well, I know what happened after the fact, but at 6 weeks into the season, it was the first week of August, I got called up to Double-A from rookie ball. I was 18 years old, and I had no business going up to Double-A at that particular time, but what had happened is that the team in A-ball was doing well. They were in a pennant race. They didn't want to disrupt their lineup, so they decided to call me up from Double-A or from rookie ball, who was doing just very decent. I mean, I was playing pretty good defense. I felt I always did that, but hitting-wise, I was just kind of getting a few hits, but not doing anything spectacular. They decided to call me up, and I think the game plan was that they were going to call me up for a couple weeks or maybe, whatever. The shortstop had gotten hurt. He had hurt his back. So they just wanted me to fill in for a short period of time and then send me back down to rookie ball. Well, lo and behold, the shortstop never healed up. They kept me up the rest of the season that month. the team was in Montgomery, Alabama, so we go into the playoffs. We win the first round of the playoffs. Then we go into the second round of the playoffs for the championship. We end up winning the whole thing, and I'm the shortstop down there. So I kind of got my foot in the door, so to speak, and that's how it ended. This was the first part of September. We went to, I was invited to the Instructional League down in Florida, and that's when I ran into a guy named Lou Whitaker. Team that I was talking about in A-ball was in a pennant race. Lou had signed a year ahead of me. He's 1 year older than I was, so he was one step ahead. So the year in 76 when I signed, he was in Lakeland. He was a third baseman. He was the MVP of the Florida State League. A week later, they converted him to second base. He never saw third base again, and that's when we hooked up. And for 2 months down in the Florida Instruction League, we worked together daily, and that's how it all started as far as our timing and our working together that we did for so many years. The following year, 1977, we went to AA to start the season. We played the season together. We won the championship again down there, and then September, they decided to call us up to the big leagues. And the last month of the season, we got some playing time up in the big leagues. And then the following season, we made the team, and we played 19 years together. So that's kind of the way it went. We were very fortunate. We got our foot in the door, and we did well enough to keep our head above water. Bottom line is the team was struggling at that particular time. They were looking for young talent, but we happened to be in the right place at the right time. Did well enough for us to keep us there. And then over the next few years, we started to develop mentally and physically, because when we came up at 19, 20 years old, to say that we were a little overmatched, I would have to say that we probably could have used a little more seasoning, but we did enough to keep our head above water and do enough to stay there. And then, after a year or so in the big leagues, we started to get a little stronger, get a little better. That Ibar switch that you see, if you've been out to the games, he's a left-handed hitter, and they play everybody over to left field. I'm not going to say it was quite that bad, but when Lou Whitaker and I first started, they had a similar switch that they shaded everybody over. Lou was a left-handed hitter, and for a right-handed hitter, I hit almost every ball over to right field. And Gates Brown was our hitting coach in our first few years in the big leagues, and he told us, over time that, we're going to need to keep those people honest. We're going to have to learn how to pull the ball occasionally and keep those guys honest. And over the next few years, we were able to do that. And then, of course, we both turned into be able to hit a few home runs. Lou ended up hitting, almost 250 for his career. I hit almost a little bit under 200. So we were able to keep people honest, even though we weren't that big. That's part of the learning process, and you start learning the pitchers a little bit and getting a little more confidence. It's amazing what you can do, even though you're not that big. So that's how it all started. I mean, as far as the big leagues, there's so many great memories. That's very true, that the fundamentals, people are more. And I'd have to say that TV has a big reason why it's that way, because everybody, the highlights you see are the flamboyant play, and that's what people see, and that's what they want to go out and emulate. And but the fact of the matter is that any team that wins in any level, you talk about defense first, it's always true, football, basketball, baseball, it's the same thing. The teams that do those things better than the other ones and don't give up in baseball, if you don't give the other team an extra out or two on a regular basis, you have a much better chance to win. If you go back, just for an example, 1988, when the Dodgers beat the Oakland Athletics, everybody thought on paper that it was going to be a murder for Oakland. I mean, they had the Bash brothers, and they had a pretty good pitching staff. But Oral Hershiser and a couple of the other pitchers there, they stuck it up, they stuck it to them. And what happens is good pitching allows you to stay in ball games. So when you get late in the game, maybe you're down by one or two runs. But as a player, if you're down by one or two runs, you still feel you have a chance to win. If you're down trailing consistently four or five runs, you might come back occasionally, but let's be realistic, it's not going to happen on a regular basis. But if you're down by only a run or two or tied, you have a chance. That's what good pitching does. It allows you to stay in ball games. And playing good defense, pitching and defense go hand in hand. It allows you to stay in more ball games. So even if you don't have the best hitting attack, you're still in ball games, and sooner or later, guys get a guy on base, you start feeling, hey, we can win this game. it happens more times than you would think.
Alan?
Yes?
That I saw the Cruz kid in Lakeland, and I've just been dumbfounded the way he has played. And what's your opinion at the long range? Is he going to be a superstar?
I don't know if he's going to be a superstar. And the only reason why I say that is because when I'm looking at that, I'm looking at a guy like Alex Rodriguez, those kind of offensive numbers. Defensively, he's already playing like a superstar, but I don't know. He's going to hit better, but I don't know if he's ever going to be a well over 300, hit 30 home runs, that kind of a guy. So I think he's going to be a very solid major league player. One thing about Davey Cruz that he's already shown me is that he's very solid. He's very fundamentally sound, which we're just talking about. He is not, and in general, you see a lot of the Latin players, they're a little bit more flamboyant. They do a lot of things, especially fielding-wise. They throw a lot of balls on the run. They don't get their feet underneath them. This is not your normal guy like that. He gets his feet underneath him. He's always under control. He was taught very, very well. And he has the instincts that you want from a good infielder. And watching him has been a pleasure. I'm awfully proud of the fact that he has come from A-ball. He's come from A-ball to the major leagues. That's a tremendous jump. And to be able to hold his own, and he's hitting around 225, and which doesn't sound like that good. But I'll tell you, watching him hit, he's not an easy out either. He puts the ball in play. I think he's second on the team in doubles. And defensively, he's right now, he's playing on a level like Omar Vizquel, who's with Cleveland, who's been a gold glover. That's how well he's playing this year. So. He has played extremely well, and the Detroit Tigers are very happy to have him.
It's funny,
Well, I mean, I don't think that you're going to see too many players play that long, but I mean, if you go back in the history of the game, you don't see too many guys that have played even back years ago. It just doesn't happen that often. If you get 15 years in the major leagues, you've went well past the average over average major league career. So to play with one team, you know, never say never. I mean, it'll happen occasionally, but it won't happen a lot. I mean, again, with free agency, that certainly has made that going to be a little bit more tougher, a little more difficult. But you'll have a few guys, for whatever reason, it just happens to work out that, Tony Gwynn, Cal Ripken, those are two guys, they're not going anywhere. And at this point, I don't know of anybody off the top of my head that stands out. You know, I would have to think that a guy like Ken Griffey Jr. Is not going to go anywhere in his career. But, you never know. But I would have to think that he's got a pretty good chance to be a Mariner for the rest of his career. What happened with me is after the 1980 season, I signed a 7-year contract. And at the time, I was 22 years old, and I felt like I was going to get the security that I wanted. And I would get him again. I was going to be 29 at the time. I felt like if I played like I felt I could, that I would still be in my prime, that I'd be able to last a number of more years longer, which I did, and it ended up working for me. So, and before that 7-year contract was up, I signed a couple-year extension, so I really had like a 9-year contract. So I was, I knew I had a contract, and I knew what I needed to do, and I always stayed in shape in the offseason, so I was a little bit different than some of the others. Then later on in my career, I knew, and I did these contracts by myself. I went upstairs and just talked just like this, and it didn't take very long to get a deal done. So I never really was close. 2 years ago, going into my last year, I had some inquiries from the Yankees and from Cleveland to come over there, and I said thanks, but no thanks. The Tigers have offered me a contract. I didn't have it done yet, but I said as long as they want me back, I'm not going anywhere. Well, it was a treat to play for Sparky. I'm a little biased, and I don't know if you guys like him or not, but from my perspective, he was like a second father to me. He came. It bothers me when I hear the people have said that he wasn't good with young players, and I laugh when I hear that. And the reason why I laugh is that when he came over, we had Lou Whitaker, Kirk Gibson, myself, Jack Morris, Dan Petrie. There's a few other guys that I'm missing. Steve Camp, Lance Parrish. Jason Thompson, a couple of guys didn't last that long. He traded some of those guys, but the majority of those guys lasted a long time. What were we when he came over? We were young players. We were very young. We were younger than some of these kids that are in the big leagues now. For that, I owe a lot to him. The things that I was taught when I get involved with baseball now and I try to help the young kids, a lot of the things that he taught me is what I teach to them. There's basics. Baseball's changed to a certain degree as far as being flamboyant and stuff, but it's some of the same principles that you need, they'll never change. And that's what I try to help these kids with. So I love the man very dearly. He's retired in Lakeland, Florida. He's got four girls that him and his wife were raising. His wife has a clothing store down there, and he's kind of retired, and he's a religious guy that's gotten into the church and all, and does that, but he raises, watching his four girls grow up. I'm not going to say that he would never, but he is not an outgoing sports guy. He played the game very, very well, but he was not didn't watch the ESPN, didn't read the sports page like I did kind of thing. We were different in that regards, but when we were on the field, we had a bond together. But he might get back into baseball, but maybe on a limited basis. But he wouldn't be out there all the time. That's just not the way his personality is.
Did Detroit sit down and talk with you in programming what you're going to be doing now?
No, I mean, as far as what my role is?
Yeah.
Well, I had Randy Smith, our general manager, when I signed my last contract for 1996, we had worked out a deal that I was going to be around for a couple years. I had already had that predetermined.
Doing this.
And then last winter when the season was over, we sat down and really kind of said, okay, I'd like for you to do this, this, and this. And I said, well, I'd like to do this too. And we kind of, you know, had some predetermined assignments. And because I've enjoyed it so much, I've added on a lot more assignments than I initially was required to do. To be honest with you, I'm a baseball guy and I love it.
Well, I can tell.
And you know, they didn't know, I guess initially they didn't want to say, well, we want you to go everywhere like that. Well, like going to the Dominican last week, I feel it's very important. Latin America is big in baseball, as we know. And to me, I get all these reports, you know, on a voicemail, we have a Dominican Summer League team, you get all those reports from every club. And to not be able to put a face together and really not know their country since I've never been there, it's amazing. It was a culture shock, and it was an eye-opening experience to go down to the Dominican Republic, and now I know why those kids want to get over to the States so bad. It's bad, and it was bad, but it was very worthwhile, where we brought eight of us from the Tiger organization down there, and six of us had never been down there before. So for all of us, it was a great experience to see it firsthand. And now we can put the voicemail together, the picture or the faces of these players, sitting here in a voicemail, and you don't even know who this player is. Now we know who they are. We were able to give their coaching staff some instruction and give them a format that we do as a Tiger organization to help those kids out. So it was a very worthwhile trip that we took.
Who's training the Dominicans down there? I mean, they have their own coaching staff?
Yeah,
players? Or?
There's some former players, but they're, you know, they're, of course, they've got to speak Spanish, you know, and that's a difficult thing, especially to have, you know, now that we're getting some Latin kids in our organizations, you know, we're getting a better job of hiring some instructors that do speak, but they're bilingual.
There was an article, I think, in
the real Detroit Tiger prospects, David Cruz on the left and Juan Encarnacion on the right.
Yeah, he's very good. He's very good. He is one of the, if he was in the draft this year, they talked about J.D. Drew. He was the number two pick in the country, and we were considering him with the number one pick in the country. Juan Encarnacion, there'd be no contest, and who would you pick? And they're the same age. No contest. This guy is a five-tool guy, and you don't find very many guys like that that can do the run, the throw, the hit with power, hit for average, that kind of thing. He does it all. He could actually, he's a right fielder. He could play center field in the big leagues right now.
Alan, you got to stop. Fifth tool. You got me hanging up
there. Yeah, what's the fifth tool? Yeah, defense.
In 1996, one of the catchers for the Jamestown Jammers was Rob Fick. He came to our team as to being drafted in the fifth round of the 1996 June draft. He came here with high expectations, however, only had a .248 batting average. You'll hear Alan talk about Rob Fick and his prospects, but note that 2 months after this interview, Rob Fick would end up the 1997 season as the Midwest League MVP and batting champion with a .341 batting average. 2 years later, he would be in the major leagues, which is where we caught up with him to take this picture in Erie, Pennsylvania in 1999.
Robert Fick, he didn't hit a home run here last year. He had a 32-game hit streak earlier this year. He's hitting roughly .360 and hitting for some power. And, you know, but he was not right last year. He was drafted last June. Came here, had some sort of a virus that wasn't detected, and this year he's a pretty good prospect.
Isn't there a reason that helped him with moving him to first base?
Yeah, well, that's, you know what, because of this virus, we're gonna send him to Hawaii. There's a Hawaii like an instruction league over there. We're gonna send him back to catch. We want to see if he can still catch. Because he's shown he can play first base. He could actually, he's played some third base too. He is not the player that we saw last year. And I didn't see him. I'm just going on what people said. This is not, we think he can catch. His ability and his actions and his instincts, we think, and we want to see if he can. We don't want to totally say that he can't. So we want to see if he possibly can. Because the more positions that he can play, if he can play catcher and first, his value goes up. You can see somebody and they can look well, so good, and then baseball is going to knock you down a peg all the time, and that's the constant adjustment fighting the game.
Because how has he been mentally,
though? He's actually done, he started off a little slow in AAA, as you would expect. I'm sure he was hurt. Then he got it going and has played very well. And Bubba's going to have to hit to make it to the big leagues, and I think he will. Because I think except for Juan Encarnacion in Double A, I don't see a better hitter in our organization. He's got power to right field and to left field, which you don't see very often. And he sometimes is his own worst enemy, as most players are. They're hard on themselves, and they get down a little bit. You got to fight that, and that's a constant battle of baseball. Let me tell you, I don't care if you play 1 year, 20 years. You're gonna fight it. Even guys like Ken Griffey Jr. and Barry Bonds and Tino Martinez, guys like that, nobody just cruises through a season. Tony Gwynn goes through a couple ruts here and there, as good as he is. And that's just, and I say it's just baseball. It's a humbling game. It humbles you more than any other one, I think, because you play so many games. So you're gonna fail so often, and you can't let that bother you. And easier said than done, though, because when you're scuffling, it bothers you.
Well, I think our current third baseman just said that. He's got 100 pounds on his back. Mm-hmm.
Right.
How do you change that? I mean, your fielding skills are, of course, something that's ingrained and embedded. How do you change somebody you mentioned, like David Cruz? He's going to get better, you know, and guys.
He's going to get the experience of learning. See, that I think one thing at the big league level that's easier, in my opinion, is that over the years, not that you want to face Roger Clemens or Randy Johnson on a daily basis, but I would rather face guys like that than a young kid that I've never seen before. In my mind, I've faced them a number of times, so I have that security blanket. I know what they've got. They're going to get you out. But I know that in the back of my mind, they're not going to trick me with this kind of a pitch. A young kid, I might not be sure what his velocity is or his movement or his breaking ball, and I think that it's easier when you've played a long period of time. Doesn't mean that you don't make little adjustments, you do, but I feel like it's easier once you establish yourself and continue to play, that you just know the guys year in and year out. Well, right out of the get-go, when we knocked on the door, 83, we had a pretty good year. We fought Baltimore. They ended up winning the World Series that year, but we were close to them. Going into spring training in 84, we felt very confident that we were going to be successful. But right out of the get-go, we started 35-5, and it gives you the confidence. Sports is contagious. Winning, losing is contagious. We were just confident that we were going to win. And through that 35-5, we won 17 games in a row on the road. It was just an unbelievable feeling. Whatever we needed, we got it done. I mean, guy coming off the bench contributing. It was just everybody was part of it. And then throughout the season, we just carried it on. And then later on in the season, we felt a little bit of pressure for the fact that because we had had such a tremendous season, that nobody would have really remembered us if we didn't win it all. So we felt like we had to win it all, even though deep down we felt we would.
You're right, it might be going way back, and it is out of here, a three-run homer by Evans. And the Tigers have an 8-1 lead. Evans hit one deep to right field to score three runs on one big blow here in the seventh inning.
Working up the set position now, he goes to his set. Kittle waits, here it comes. He struck him out, and Morris has a no-hitter. Lance Parrish goes out and grabs him, and the Tigers get a no-hit performance for the first time since 1958 when Jim Bunning did it.
There's a swing and a fly ball. Left field going back his order at the fence, and he won't get it. It's a grand slam for Alan Trammell, and the Tigers have the lead, 5-2.
His gift in charging them, it plans the play to throw to Parrish, and he is out at the plate. Out at the plate.
Sorensen delivers. Here's a swing and a high fly ball deep left, and that is long gone. It is a grand slam for Lance Parrish.
1984 was just an unbelievable season. It's probably something that I'll never get an opportunity to experience again in my playing career. To go 35-5 at the beginning of the season is just something that is beyond comprehension as far as I'm concerned. I sat down a few times while we were in the midst of doing that and saying to myself, I can't believe that we're actually playing against Major League ball clubs.
I don't know who, you know, in the back of their minds was hoping that the Tigers would slip, but this is something I didn't want to happen. And, you know, it was, you only get a year that things like this happen.
That year was a childhood dream of everybody on our team at that time because it was just too good to be true. We led from start to finish, which is an unheard of thing to happen in the major leagues, let alone the American League East. And the pressure was really more on us all through the year than if the race was closer because everybody was shooting at us. Everybody was waiting for us to falter.
In 1984, that was a dream coming true.
Everybody was around our clubhouse, and it was one of those years that everybody thought we had it won by June 1st. Now, I've seen too many times where this can disappear on you, and I would say that 84 of all my years was the one that I thought was the toughest on me. ability in the world is not going to continue to keep winning. Ability comes first, but then you must have...
Kansas City Royals, 3-0 in the playoffs. We ended up playing the Padres in the World Series, and I think I was probably the only guy that wanted to go to San Diego, being that I was raised there and had been in that ballpark but never played there. You know, everybody wanted to play the Cubs, being a short trip, and people in Detroit were talking about going back to 1945 when it was the Cubs and the Tigers World Series. But, you know, the Padres kind of sniped them a little bit. They were down 2-0, and they went back to San Diego and swept them out there. And so we played the Padres. We played the first 2 games out there. And right out of the get-go, just like we had done during the season, Lou got a double to start the first game, first hit, first batter. I got a base hit and knocked him in. We were up 1-0 right out of the get-go. We got a couple more runs. We win the first game. They won the second game. We split in San Diego. We fly
out of the slab. He winds. He pitches. There's a swing and a fly ball to center field. Brown going back. It's deep. And he won't get it. It's off the wall. Whitaker going for two. And he has a leadoff double. He hit the ball to deep left center. The pitch. Swung on. There's a line drive to left. It'll be in for a hit. Here comes Whitaker around third. He's being waved at the plate. Here's a throw. Not in time.
Swung on. A fly ball. Deep right field. Going back is Gwynn. He's at the track. He's looking. It's gone. A two-run homer by Larry Herndon. And the Tigers take a 3-2 lead here in the fifth inning over San Diego.
Here's the pitch on the way. Swung on. A bounding ball to right. Base hit. Down in the bullpen. Chased by Gibson. Babakwa going for two. Gibson picks up the ball in the corner. Babakwa headed for three. Here's the throw by Whitaker to Castillo. He's out at third. Templeton waiting on a 2-2 pitch. Swing and a ground ball to first base. Bergman has it, makes the play unassisted. The Tigers have won the first game of the World Series.
Two former minor league teammates who went on to great managing careers greet before game three. First ball honors this night belong to venerable John Fetzer, former owner and now chairman of the Tiger team.
Marty swings, long belt to left. That one is gone. A home run. 2-0 lead for the Tigers in the second inning. Trammell swings as a line drive hit to left field. Down in the corner, chased down by Martinez. Here's Whitaker rounding third. He's being waved home. Here's a relay by Templeton. Not in time. The ball gets by Kennedy. He's backed up by Lala. Trammell holds it second. The Tigers lead 3-0. Here it comes. He swings as a fly ball to center. Glimmon going back, still back, reaches, makes the catch. Here's the pitch. He swings. There's a drive to left. It's deep. It is way back, and it is gone. A two-run homer by Trammell. A 2-0 lead for the Tigers in the first inning. Shaw ready, kicks and deals. Here's a swing, and there's another drive to left. It's deep, and this one is gone. The second home run by Trammell. And the Tigers now lead it 4-1. Whitaker scores. Here comes Trammell running home his second consecutive home run. Two out of number two. Here's the windup, and here's the pitch, and he swings as a drive to right. Gibson there. He's got it. The Tigers win it. And they take the series lead to 3-2.
It's a 2-3-2 series. We swept them in Detroit. We didn't want to go back to San Diego. Game three, I forget what the score was. Got a couple hits. Game four was the game that I had. My first two times up, I hit 2-2-run homers. We won 4-2 that game. Jack Morris pitched, and I drove in all four runs that game with 2-2-run homers. So that was kind of the game that people remember me for. And then the fifth game is when Gibby hit a couple home runs and kind of iced the one game off of Goose Gossage. And if you see some of the highlights, there's some tape, and they've got a microphone on Sparky and Dick Williams, the manager of the Padres. And the situation was, is that Lou Whitaker had got on. I had bunted him over. They wanted to walk. They wanted to walk Kirk Gibson. The base was open. And Dick Williams put the four sign up for an intentional walk, and Goose shook his head. And so he walked out to the mound, and they got it right on the tape, you know, saying, well, you think you could strike him out? He goes, yeah. He had faced him 9 times prior to that and struck him out 9 times. Well, he didn't strike him out that time. Hit a home run. And that basically, at that time, put the game away. And
there's a swing and a low one. It's gone. A home run by Gibson. Upstairs, 2-0 Tigers in the first inning.
Tiger fifth inning, game tied 3-3. The pitch to Rusty. He swings and pops it up. Short right field. That's not going to bring anybody in. Out goes Wiggins. The second baseman makes the catch. Gibson's coming home. Here's the throw, and it's not in time. Boom! He fooled him.
Wiggins is a bat to left. It's deep. Martinez going back. He leaps. He won't get it. It is a home run for Parrish, and the Tigers have a 5-3 lead.
We don't want to walk you.
That we were going to be world champs, and it was a great feeling to run off that field. And all three times when we won the division, we were at home. When we won the pennant, when we beat the Royals, we were at home. And when we won the World Series, we were at home. And not that the celebrations would be that much different, but to have three celebrations all at home, it was special. You know, with all your family there and your fans there. It just capped off a dream season, you know. And at that time, we thought we were going to do it again, and maybe again and again. But lo and behold, it never worked out. In '87, we won the division, but we lost in the playoffs. But '84 was a dream season.
MVP of the series.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Willie Hernandez was the MVP and the Cy Young Award winner of the baseball season. He had a tremendous year coming out of the bullpen. Willie had the best year, I mean, statistically, but nobody hit 30 home runs, nobody drove in 100 runs. But if you look at the contributions, we had a lot of guys had 20 to 25 home runs, a lot of guys had 80 to 90 RBIs. It was a total team effort.
As Alan indicated, he was awarded the 1984 World Series MVP. And to date, this is the last time the Tigers have made the World Series. A class act, Alan Trammell.
The organization has been great to me. I've been very, very fortunate, and I think one of the things that, more so than playing, playing Major League Baseball, that was a dream of mine. But I think that over the years, when my name is brought up along with Lou, it'll always be Detroit Tigers. And that means as much to me as anything that I've done in statistic-wise. To be a Tiger is something I wanted to do. I was able to, fulfill that dream too. And to say, you look at your numbers and your baseball card and it has one team all the way through, and that looks mean. And it meant something to me, and a lot of people feel that way. Of course, it doesn't always happen, but once it got to be like 10, 12 years of my career, I started thinking more about that. I think when somebody signs with an organization, everybody feels the same. I'd like to play with them the whole career. Well, a couple years later, they get traded, something happens, and hey, that's just the way it happens. There's no control over it. But once you get so far in your career, I never felt like going somewhere else was, I was looking at it, I got to move my family and this and that. There's no guarantees that you're going to win over here. You might be a little bit better, but there's no guarantees you're going to win, get to the World Series. I just figured, what the heck? You better stay here.
I'm Kristen Stein, director of the Fenton History Center in Jamestown, New York. We hope you've enjoyed this presentation, which is just one of many stories from our community's rich history. The Fenton History Center preserves our shared history through the presentation of educational programs and exhibits, the maintenance of a collection of local artifacts and archival materials, and a library specializing in local history and genealogy, all for the benefit and use of the public. For more information about the Fenton History Center and its activities, call 664-6256.